Hi everyone. So I suppose the main reason you're all here today is to find out more about the staycation tax relief there that's coming into play in October. So what I'm going to talk to you about today is I'm just going to run through a few different areas. So the first thing we are going to cover is the stay and spend scheme, what qualifies and how you claim it back. Another area that might be really interesting to people this year is the working from home, what tax relief you can get in relation to it, what your employer can pay for you. For it because it's becoming more prominent now this year and going forward. Then I'm going to touch lightly, and I say very lightly, onto the tax implications of the pandemic unemployment payments or the wage subsidy treatment of it and the resulting underpayments that people may face in relation to it. And then after that, we'll swing it back around to a more favourable topic. There are other tax reliefs that you can claim, how you can increase your refunds or reduce any liabilities you might have and how to kind of optimise your position there. Then I'll talk a little bit about ourselves here in taxback.com, so how you get to know us. And then at the end of then we'll open it all up for a quick Q&A session there. So if there's anything that I've covered that you want a bit more detail on, you can pop in a question there, or you can get out at the end of there if there's anything you're not clear about. If you do have any kind of personal questions, I know people don't like to bring up on a forum like this there, if you want to actually talk specifically about your own taxes, feel free to pop me an email after the session and we can talk more specifically about your own cases there. So to go on to the stay and spend, so what is the stay and spend scheme? So in the July stimulus there, on the 23rd of July, included in that was what's called the stay and spend scheme. What is that? Well, under that scheme, you're entitled to claim tax relief on any qualified expenditure incurred from the 1st of October until the 13th of April next year. Qualifying expenditure, what is that? So it's anything you spend in any local hotel, restaurant, accommodation, and food. Their main thing to bear in mind in relation to it is non-alcoholic drinks only can be included there. So any alcoholic drinks, so say when the wet bars open up again next Monday, there, unfortunately, your expenses there aren't deductible, can't be included in there, but if you go for a meal tonight, there that can be included. Minimum threshold for it is €25 for a single transaction. So if you go to Costa Coffee today and you buy two coffees and one and it comes to €20, you can't claim that there. But if you book a weekend in the Monarch and it costs you €500, you can claim that. It's per single transaction. And then you can claim up to €125 for yourself. Or if you're a married couple, it's €250. So that's kind of a maximum spend of €650 per person. Now, one really kind of key area that a lot of people aren't aware of, and it's really important, it must be by a provider, a qualified service provider, and you need to submit proof of your claim, so keep copies of your receipts. The service provider one is going to be coming kind of more important later on in there, so just to remember that one there. So how much can you claim? So I mentioned it there in the last slide. It's €125 per person, or if you're a married and jointly assessed couple, it's €250 per couple. So it's been capped there. So as I said earlier, €625 per person needs to be spent, or if it's a couple, it's €1,250. You will also have to spend at least €25 in a single transaction to be counted towards it. So if you can claim for multiple transactions, the conditions for that is, as I mentioned earlier, has to be above €25. So it means that you can go this evening and have a meal for two, costs you €50, hold on to your receipt, that can be deducted there. Then next weekend you decide to go on a staycation to Killarney yourself, that costs €300, hold on to the receipt, that can be claimed. While in Killarney you decide to go for a nice meal out, costs you €150, hold on to that as well, and they can all be claimed. So it's not just one transaction, it could be over multiple transactions, and you need to make sure that you do not exceed the €625 limit. Now when I say you do not exceed it, if you go to the Monarch and the weekend costs you €700 for yourself, hold on to that receipt, you can submit it. It's just, it's going to be capped at €125 there. And then it's important before you do anything, so before you book a meal, before you book a hotel, book a staycation, you need to make sure that the supplier, the hotel, the restaurant, the bed and breakfast that you're booking is on the approved list of service providers. So that's actually on the revenue website. So I'll show you where you can find that there on the next slide there. Just to kind of harp on again about the important things to remember. I suppose the main thing to remember with the staycation scheme there is that there's been a lot of hype in the press lately that it's quite awkward to claim, that it's cumbersome, that it's that it's unfair to people that target. It's actually quite straightforward to claim back. The main thing to remember is, first of all, in order to be able to claim it, you have to be a PAYE worker. What does that mean? Or a PAYE taxpayer, it can be self-assessed as well. It means you have to be paying PAYE tax. So if you're on social welfare payments and you don't have any tax paid in the year, you won't be able to claim it back. Or I know there's a lot of talk there about the pensioners are unable to claim it if they're on state pension and not paying any tax there. So that's the key thing to remember is if you need to be a PAYE worker. The supplier needs to be registered on the approved list of service providers and to be assigned displayed for them there. The requirements for someone to get approved as a supplier, there's a list in there. They need to be VAT registered. They have to have a valid tax clearance certificate. They need to be registered with Board of Aldermen or similar tourism body. And then they need to be registered with the HSE Environmental Health. So where that will see a lot of providers unable to get onto the scheme is, I'm sure we've all heard stories now of local pubs that have joined up with a pizzeria down the road there, that you go into the pub, you stay for an hour and a half, you order pizza from down the road, and you can have your couple of drinks there. That pub won't be able to register as a supplier because they're not going to be registered with Environmental Health Services, cook kitchen, the food is being prepared somewhere else there. I mentioned earlier about checking it, so you can check it on the Revenue website. So if you go to revenue.ie/stay-and-spend, you'll actually see it there. And it's really easy to check. So what you would all do is you go in onto the website there and you select your county. So because Dublin is so large, it's all sectioned out by Dublin 1, 2, 3, 4. For today's, because your offices are based in Dublin 2, I just selected Dublin 2 for it there. The sector, you can drop down there. So if you say, I want to go for a meal next week in Dublin, you select on that, then you can select accommodation or you can select food. For the purposes of today, I selected both. And then there's subcategories inside there, hotel, guest house, stuff like that. And then it will pull up the list. So you can go to the Best Spree, you can go to the Ivy Gardens. That's the same for all across the country. Now, when I was preparing this presentation last week, I went in to check the same there. And there was, currently at that stage, there was nobody registered in Dublin 2. So I was relieved yesterday when I went in to recheck it there for the final edge presentation, that there's a lot more providers coming online with it now. So I imagine as October is fast approaching, more and more getting registered up right there. So key thing to do is first make sure that you are a PAYE worker. And then the second thing you need to do is make sure that the provider is registered. So there's no point in us booking a weekend in a fabulous hotel down the country only to find out after the fact that they're not registered for the scheme and you can't get your money back. So that's the key thing to check before you book. And how to claim it. As I mentioned earlier, it's quite straightforward enough. So as I said, check with the supplier that the supplier is registered before you go. Keep your receipts. A lot of people make a big fuss about that as well. It's very similar to medical expenses. So hold on to your receipts. So if you have a folder at home that you're holding on to your medical receipts, your doctor's visits and prescription fees throughout the year, from now on, from the 1st of October on, just take any receipts you have for any meals, hotels, restaurants and stuff like that you book. Put them into the folder, hold on to them that way. And then you need to supply them when you're doing the application. So if you're using a provider like ourselves, simply just scan an email and over to us, like you're sending over your medical expenses. We'll go through them line by line. So if it's a case that you have a meal and it costs you 100 euros, but included in that is a bottle of wine that costs 40 euros, we'll look at it, we'll check that and we'll make sure to only submit the 60 euro that's claimable there on it. Or you can also upload them onto the revenue receipt checker. So I know there's been a lot of chatter about this there recently as well. And to be honest, it's more straightforward than people are really making it out to be. You can download the app there, and what they've added in onto it now is, you'll see there, is stay and spend. So before it used to be just health, trade, rental, other expenses. So they have a new section got in there, the health, their stay and spend, and you literally select it there, upload the receipt, put in the date, and it's saved there online there for you. So it's just another way of holding on to it there for yourselves. And then it's claimed in your tax return at the end of the year, very similar to when you're doing your form 11 or your form 12, whatever sort of tax return that you're having. If you're self-employed, you're doing the form 11, so it's get included in on that there and reduce your tax liability. Or if you're a PAYE worker, it'll go in on your form 12 and it'll increase your refund there for you. So that's kind of the basics of the stay and spend. It is a quite good scheme. So the most important thing you need to remember for yourself is, first of all, check the register, make sure where you're going is registered, and then just hold on to your receipt. After that, then you can figure out the rest of you there and include it all for yourself there. So next thing I want to touch on with you is e-working. So what is e-working? So you will be deemed as an e-worker if you work at home on a full or part-time basis, if you log onto a work computer remotely, and you work developing ideas, products and services remotely. If you're an e-worker, your employer is most likely going to provide you with the following. You get a computer, a laptop, printer, scanner if needed, office furniture like desks, chairs, and you usually will be provided with your mobile phone, your broadband, etc. I heard a statistic there last week. I think it was 3,000% the sales in office chairs went up there in the months March to September. I might have exaggerated that there, it's sort of coming into my head there, but there's a huge amount of people actually purchased their own office chairs when they were working from home there back in March. The majority of employers like our own there now are actually making these things available to them. So we have the option in our office, they can actually go in and collect all of your workstation and bring it home with you there. So we all have our desks at home and our chairs, and we're all set up that way. Another thing to bear in mind is that any tax relief you get in relation to e-working is not a benefit in kind, because the benefit to yourselves is minimal. So having your work laptop here, most of us like close it off at 6 o'clock in the evening and not look at it anymore. We're not going to be using it for Googling or Facebook and stuff like that. And working from home will not affect your principal primary residency for your CGT. So when you're selling your home 10, 15, 20 years down the line, if part of it was an office, simply an office for working for a self-employed person, something that it can actually affect your CGT. But if you're an e-worker working from home, it doesn't impact it there. So it's bear in mind, that's a good thing. Another thing to bear in mind is that there has to be a formal agreement from you and your employer. What does that mean? It means pre-COVID, we here in taxpack.com, we weren't working from home, we're office-based, 9 to 5, Monday to Friday. But if someone wanted to go above and beyond and wanted to be contacting people on a Saturday or get extra bits of work done after hours there, they'd have the option, you could take home your laptop and do work there. There's no formal agreement. That doesn't deem you as an e-worker. It just means that you're very hard working there. So you need to have a formal agreement in place, and you will need to get a letter from your employer confirming exactly what the agreement is. So if it's the case you're working from home 5 days a week on a permanent basis or 2 days a week, you need to get a letter from them. So what can your employer pay? So there's two areas that are really important to yourselves. So the first thing is your employer actually has the option of paying you an expense of €3.20 per day without deducting any PAYE, PSI or universal social charge from it there. That payment is to cover your additional costs, so your Wi-Fi, your heating, electricity bills, all the other bills that are going to incur now in the fact that we're working from home. The value of that is quite valuable, so that can be an additional €16 per week for you, €65 a month or €768 per year. So it's really valuable if your employer does that. But I suppose one thing to bear in mind is that there is no obligation to your employer to make that payment. So there's many employers that are just simply not in the financial position to do it, who aren't making any payment. Generally, we find the employers that are making €3.20 per day payment are employers that already would have had a working from home policy in place pre-COVID. So they would have had a number of staff working from home. Anyone would be making the payment. 90% of employers that found out on the 11th of March that everyone had to pack up and go work from home weren't in a position to do that there. So it's a case that they're not making any payments to the employees. But all is not lost, because there is a tax relief that you can claim. So what if your employer doesn't pay? So if your employer doesn't pay, you can actually claim a tax relief. It's called e-worker relief. It's when the employer does not give you the tax repayment amount. Or there's also a case that if your additional allowable expenses are in excess of €3.20 per day, you can claim a tax relief on the difference of it there. A few key things to bear in mind in relation to that. The revenue will only allow 10% of your expenses as an e-working expense, and assume that the other 90% of your expenses are personal use. So say, for example, your total utility bills for gas, electricity, heating, Wi-Fi comes to €2,000. They will say that €200 of that is an e-working expense. They won't give you the full value of it there, because the assumption is that the house is still going to be used for that. What evidence you will need in order to claim it? It's a letter from your employer. So as I mentioned earlier there, you need a letter from the employer confirming the exact agreement there. So it could be a case that if I in taxpack.com confirm that Marian Ryan is working from home on a permanent basis as of the 11th of March 2020, she's working 5 days a week, and our total number of working days in 2020 at home was 202. And then you need to keep copies of your utility bills. So like with every other expense, you don't need the originals of these. So what I have started doing for myself since March is anytime I get a utility bill, I'm downloading it and I'm saving it into a folder called tax. So I'll have them all gathered there together. So they're the two key areas, the two areas that you need it. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to run through an example of the actual value of it for yourself, because it's all well and good me telling you that there's a tax credit that you can claim and you have no idea how much value it will be for you. So as I mentioned earlier there, we'll say 2,000 euros as your 2020 utility bill, so your heating, your electricity, your Wi-Fi. This year, 2020, is a leap year, so different to most, we have 366 days in this year. And then we're, for the example, we're just going to assume that I was working at home for the 48 weeks of the full year. So 48 weeks, we assume 4 weeks annual leave, so that's 240 days. So we have to apportion that out. So you can only claim for the days you're working from home. So your 2,000 euros divided by 366, multiplied by 240 gives you 311.48. As I mentioned there earlier, you can only claim 10% of business use. So it's going to be 131.15 euros. So as you can see, it's dwindling down substantially as we go along the way. So what does this actually mean to yourself? What money in your pocket do you get it? If you're a higher tax payer, so if you're earning over 35,000 euros and you're in the 40% bracket, it's going to be money in your pocket, a cash refund of about 52.46 euros for you. And then if you're in the lower tax bracket, so if you're below 35,000 euros and you're just paying the 20% tax, it's going to be just 26.23 there. So you can see when you're starting with 2,000 euros, it divides down fairly small there at the end of the day. So what we're actually doing here in taxback.com is we're proposing a new flat rate expense. So a flat rate expense is something that already exists out there. It'll be tax credit of 690 euros if you are a principal in a school. There's ones for nurses about 580 euros. If you're in the National Concert Hall, there's a flat rate expense there, about 2,400 euros for you to pay for your trumpet and equipment like that. So it's already built into the tax system. So what we're proposing and what we're kind of advocating for and lobbying a lot for is that they introduce something similar, a flat rate expense for e-workers there, simply a tax credit that you get. So rather than having to rely on the employer to potentially pay the €3.20 a day, we're proposing that they build that into the flat rate expenses. So I worked it out there. So as you mentioned earlier, the value of the payment from the employer will be 768 euros. Whereas with the calculations on the last slide there, it's about 20 to 60 euros the tax credit. So there's a huge difference there. So if they do introduce the flat rate expense of €3.20 per day, it actually worked out as really good, valuable credit for people. It'd be a tax credit cash in your pocket if you're a higher taxpayer of about 330 euros and 166 euros. So it's nearly five times what's currently in place there. So what we'd be saying to people is we're doing a lot in the press lately. We're lobbying the government, we're lobbying all the politicians we can. If you're a Twitter user, if you're an avid commenter on thejournal.ie, if you're on social media a lot, if you can follow anything that we have there in relation to it, back it, tweet it, back it up there. We'll try and get it there. We're hoping, with fingers and toes and everything crossed, that there will be something introduced in the budget in October there. So we're just trying to shout as loud as we can for people between now and then. The next slide now is probably not the best slide to see there, but it's one that it does need to be kind of touched on and people need to be aware of it there. So since March, over 70,000 employers had availed of the wage subsidy scheme. So that was the subsidy they could get to keep people in work, to keep the lights on and keep people paid. And over 633,000 or 663 employees have received it. So 663,000 of us have our employers availing of the wage subsidy scheme there. It's nearly a similar number again then in relation to the pandemic unemployment payment. So statistics are saying there's in or around a million, if not more, people that have availed of one or the other services there. What does this mean to your tax? It's really important for people to know and remember that these payments are taxable and not deducted at source. What does that mean? It means you're getting the full 350 euros if you were on the pandemic unemployment payment back in March there, or your employer was getting the full payment there for yourself, but there's no POIE or USC deducted at source. But they are deemed as a taxable income. So it means come the end of the year, there's going to be a review done on your taxes and you'll have to pay the USC and POIE in relation to it. And we're estimating that there'll be between 1,000 and 3,000 euros of an underpayment there for people that have availed it. Now, that sounds really dramatic, so just to kind of ease people's mind, that's on the assumption that people have received the full amount of the payment for 23 weeks from like March into September. If it's the case that you're only on it for a couple of weeks throughout the year, it's not going to be as painful there for people. And what we need to bear in mind is that things like your tax credit, the working from home, stay and spend, unused tax credit, they'll all be used as well to reduce it down there for you. So I'm going to throw up two examples here, and they might frighten people, and it's not to frighten people, it's just to try and explain it a bit. So what we've done is we've taken two different salaries, 35,000 euros, say your average construction worker salary, and 67,500 euros, your average project manager salary. When we work it down there, assuming that people are working for 23 weeks on the wage subsidy scheme, that their employer is getting the full benefit of it, if you're a 35,000 euro worker, your underpayment could be about 1,300 euros for the year. And you may actually see a slight rise in your pay. So you might actually see about an increase of about 15 euros in your take home pay, not knowing that there's no tax gone from it, which means at the end of the year, you'll have an underpayment there of about 1,300 euros. Run the same figures over again here for the project manager. It's even more dramatic. So they'll see a reduction in net pay. So in order for your employer to have availed of the wage subsidy for you, they've had to have introduced pay cuts to get it, to get your wage to that. And then in addition to that, there's going to be an underpayment. So you'll see a reduction in your net pay of about 1,100 euros. You'll see an underpayment there of about 2,800 euros. And all in all, when you combine them there, what's actually going to be the impact for yourself is going to be at 3,900 euros. So it's something huge. And I know those numbers are really frightening to people. So if I frightened anyone with that, don't be. These are nearly kind of like worst case scenario ones. This is before we start building in your different tax credits and expenses and reliefs there. So that's what we're here to help with. If you're the same worker, so say you're a 35,000 euro worker and you lost your job completely and you're on the pandemic unemployment payment, your underpayment will be in around this region, same region there, about 1,300 euros if you received it for all the weeks. But it could be a case that you may have unused tax credits for the year. That could kind of ease that up a bit there if yourself. And similar then would be the figures for the pandemic unemployment payment for the project manager there, except they'll see an even more stark drop in their net pay because it could be going down to 300 euros a week, down to 200 and odd now at the moment there. So once we have the sadness of that there, the heavy part over, we'll talk about what we can do to increase your refunds. So we've already spoke about the stay and spend scheme there. That's a tongue twister in itself. That's going to help increase your refunds for you or reduce your underpayments if you have it. We'll keep talking about refunds from now on in there. So that's really good. It'll help you there. The e-worker relief, it may only be up to 60 euros there for you, but we look at everything as building blocks there for you. So every little 50 euros, 60 euros, 100 euros here can help build up the refunds there for you. In addition to that, then I just want to highlight the ones I'm always harping on about these ones, but they are the key ones. So medical expenses, you get 20% of your non-reimbursed medical expenses back. So that's any doctor's visit you have, any prescription fees you have, any consultants, physiotherapy, anything like that, you can get 20% back on it. The non-routine dental one is really key there for people. Braces, that's the most common one. Root canals, crowns, veneers, get 20% back on that. You're not going to get braces costing you less than 3,000-4,000 euros. It's 20% of that you can get back, so make sure that they're included and claimed. Flat rate expenses, I mentioned them earlier there with the e-workers and the flat rate expenses that were advocating there. Already, there still is, I think it's about 250 different flat rate expenses that are available there for people. So doctors get 695 euros a year, teacher 518, if you're a shop assistant working retail, it's 121 euros. And as I mentioned there, the concert orchestra. So it's really important to look into these things, bring it all in there. If you're a teacher and you're not getting your flat rate expenses, that's 500 euros per year that you're missing out on there. We can go back 4 years there, so it could be up to 2,000 euros of a value to yourself. Another one there is tuition fees, which I think is quite controversial at the moment as well there. So you can get 20% of your cost back over the threshold. So what's the threshold? It's 3,000 euros if you're in full-time education, and it's 1,500 euros if you're in part-time education. I know there's a lot of chatter now lately about the level of fees that are being charged to people when all the college courses are being done remote for 2021, but that it is out there at the moment. And a key area as well is if it's a case that you're a family and you have two children in college at the same time, that €3,000 is just capped for once. So if you have two students in college and their fees are €8,000 for the year, you take away the €3,000 and you get tax relief on the €5,000 there. So it can be really valuable to include it in there for you as well. Another area that really triggers refunds a lot for people, and people are very resistant to it, it's the change in your marital status. So anytime there's a change in your marital status, it's going to trigger a refund for you. It's going to be good for your taxes. So the one that we advertise a lot and that gets highlighted a lot is the year of marriage. So if you got married in 2019, we can review for 2019 to see if there's a refund there for you, and we can arrange them for you to be jointly assessed going forward. We always advocate for people to go for joint assessment. People are always reluctant to do it. They say, I don't want to give my credits to my husband. I don't want to give my credits to my wife. The tax credits, rates and bans for a married couple are exactly double what they are for a single person there, but it just gives you the flexibility to share them between yourselves. And then other areas that are high refund amounts, underclaimed, home care is tax credit. That's also going to come into play a lot this year. So say, started at the year, married couple, you've two kids at home, and pandemic started, and one of you lost your job completely. There's a tax credit that you can actually claim. We call the home carers tax credit, and it's worth about 1,500 or 1,200 euros a year. Single parent child carers credit, a really valuable credit as well if you're a single parent and you're the primary carer of a child. And there's a dependent relative tax credit. So the mum and dad are living down the road there, they're incapacitated due to old age, I can actually claim a tax credit due to the fact that they're dependent on me. So I am very conscious here now that I've talked an awful lot. So I'm just going to fly through these here because they're straightforward enough. So how to claim. So key thing to remember, you can claim for the last 4 years. So 2016, 2019 are currently open for review. You can claim them directly through the revenue, or you can claim them through an agency like ourselves, taxback.com. What evidence do you need to keep? Documentation. The main thing is to keep your receipts. So for your doctor's visits, for your hotel stays, and for that, keep your receipts. And then if you are claiming working from home relief, make sure and get a letter from your employer. Now, before you all go rushing out to your employers now requesting them, wait till year end. And then at year end, 90% of employers are going to do a mass letter for people, send them out and confirm everything out there. Because the year hasn't finished, they can't do you a letter now confirming for this year. And then I'll throw these up here really quickly, but I'm sure if you've attended before, you'll know all the stuff I'm going to be flagging here. So why would you choose those? I suppose there's the individual consultation that we do for people. So we go through your circumstances, which we make sure we try and maximize the refund for you. We've been doing it over 20 years now, so we're used to having conversations with people, probe it out, figure out what tax rates you're entitled to, make sure we include everything in it. The whole process is done online, so the questionnaire that we get you to fill in takes about 2 minutes. We have 24/7 online support, and we also have our office open 9 to 5 Monday to Friday with people on call there to actually talk you through if you need help in it. And the average refund we get for people is over 1,076 euros, about 1,100 euros that we get for people over the 4 year period. So it's definitely worthwhile engaging with us there.